Hello, everybody. Inner Outer Space Harmony. You are here with us today, and we're going to do some cube and some other things. But before we start with that, I just want to respond to something that Fabian and I have been talking about last week, which is contralateral. And if we just use the word contralateral, it's cross-lateral, right? So it's like, here's midline. This is one side. And as soon as we cross, we're contralateral. So even if it's just one part, that's just in just the semantics of it. But okay, so let's start with a little bit of landing inside. And we did this before. We did it once before where we conceived of a shape and sort of landed in it. But let's just land in the shape of our own body to start out. So we are in our body, and maybe also eyes open before we close them, and in the room, and just letting yourself check out the space, orienting the inner and the outer a little bit. So yeah, orienting what it is to be inside, what it feels like inside, and then also outside, and just tuning into that inner outer orientation and noting when you shift. So this is the thing, like sometimes we don't notice things and then suddenly we arrive and we're in a different place. So see if you can bring your awareness into the shift. I'm in the outer, I'm in the inner. And just see if you can take your awareness back and forth and carry it with you. So the awareness is shining the light on where are you traveling in your awareness? Is it out or is it in? And take a few breaths with that. See if, is it possible to close your eyes and still be sort of in the outer? Or is it possible to leave your eyes open and really tune to the inner? So just seeing how awareness lands, inner and outer, where is it and when does it shift? Can you follow it? Can you stick with it? Can you attend to the outer and the inner at the same time? Or maybe one sense, the eyes may be in the outer and something else, the kinesthetic is in the inner. So thinking of there's many possibilities of this. There's no one way or one answer, and you might have some special skills that nobody else can do. So just feeling into what that is, inner and outer. When are you in there on the inner and when are you outer? Can you take your hearing to the inner? Or the outer? And your felt sense, can you bring the felt sense to the surface, to the edge of you, or can you take it deep inside? So pinging back and forth with felt sense, inner and outer. And one more thing just to note, I maybe am flooding you with way too much information. If you need to just stick in one idea, just stay with that idea and you can even mute me and just stick with it for a little while. So feel free to really work in what's gonna work for you. And the last thing I wanted to think about was, I've forgotten what it is. Maybe it'll come back. I'm just gonna slow down and come into sense of self. So maybe feeling the movement of the surface area, feeling the movement of the skin, feeling the movement of the outer toward the outer, and compared to the movement of the deep inner, or even just below the surface. Yeah, so if we weren't gonna spend a lot of time in space, in outer space and inner space, then if we were just focusing on sensation, I think we could spend the whole hour in any one of those ideas playing back and forth. But since we're gonna move along, I just wanna have a quick ask of, did anyone notice anything that was a surprise or new? Is that a dawn? I see you coming in.
actually not surprising particularly, but it is interesting that I'm really familiar with eyes open, paying attention to in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. And I'm really unfamiliar with eyes closed, paying attention to out. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think most of us are, right? We are usually not. Unless people have, I think when people have experienced a lot of trauma and hypervigilance, then there's always a sense of what's happening outside. And so shutting that down, coming to inner is actually really hard. To inner alone, you know? So I think just to bear in mind, like when are, that's right, we're lucky if we can easily close our eyes and just be in there. Anything else? Yeah, Dana.
Yeah, I had an interesting sensation after doing all the shifts with inner and outer and seeing and hearing and everything. And then I was looking out the window and I was, the shape that I was looking at from the outer as I shifted to the inward, because we were doing that back and forth, the shape came inside. I mean, I really had this feeling that the shape came inside me and I could embody the shape. So then I started playing with that, seeing other shapes in the space and having them inside my body instead of outside. That was kind of cool.
That's awesome. I feel like that's where, you know, having the concept or having the image or having whatever that connects you to another layer of feeling or sensation is so rich, which is why, like, we've been doing some work in certain groups of, that overlap this group with fascia and with the irregular polyhedra that's together and reforming and forming and changing. So I feel like when we have that, because I keep thinking about this, me and Cassie are talking about it also, like, how is that with hydration, with movement, those polyhedras are shifting and changing. And so that's why, like, really three-dimensional movement, spiraling, using space, using all of this motion, or how, like, we've done this before where we spiral into directions, like maybe finding twisting and spiraling ways to get out into space, what that does into the fascia. So just thinking of, again, that image or that idea of something, and how does it change our experience of being a person, right? I see a shape outside and then I feel that shape inside myself. That's a new idea or a new experience for me, or maybe not for other people, but just each of these are these layers of coming into richness. But that's gonna, I'll ask again, but let's go right back in, because that's a great lead in to what we're gonna do right now, which is to close our eyes and imagine that we are seated inside of a perfect cube. So that we have a face in front of us, a face behind us, a face on either side, one on top and one below. So you're inside of a cube. The corners are like right forward high, left forward high, right forward low, left forward low, right back high. Those are your corners. But inside this perfect cube, you're seated in there. Can you imagine that cube outside of you facing a face of your cube? And then taking a minute or 2 minutes to maybe explore through movement what you could explore. And I'm not saying how big or small your kinis cube is. It could be really far at the edges, or it could be really close to you, however, but to find a way with your body, with your movement, to explore where are the surfaces, where are the edges, where are the corners of that cube? And you can move this. So you're finding those corners of this imaginary cube that you're in. And as you're in that discovery of finding the outer surfaces, the inner scaffolding, maybe just the mime version of that flat wall in front of you or to your sides or over your head, however that's interesting to play with, are there locations that you're drawn to, and are there locations that you're not really paying much attention to? So see if it's possible to pay equal attention to the entire cube, to that entire polyhedra. Can you, maybe with movement, maybe just with your mind, really feel the back space, the side space, the down space, the corners, the diagonals? Or maybe you can just feel it with your skin. Just finding as if you're in that cube, finding and breaking all rules of Laban. You can explore it in any way that's interesting. You could explore the seams of the cube, the corners and the edges. And you can use any body part. You can not have to do a scale or anything like that, but just finding where are those edges. So here's my, coming back to the screen for 1 second, here's my smashed cube, my irregular polyhedra that I am going to bring now into the shape of a cube. I've been trying to find a way to stabilize these corners. It's just tape and string. It's not working very well. So you can see the possibilities of the inner structure. If it stayed in the shape of a cube. There we go. Hold on. It was in much better form a couple of days ago, but the tape has gotten weaker and weaker. So there's my, the possibility. I wanted to make one of those open ones. If I were to take the octahedron, I could sit my octahedron inside of my cube, right? So here's my up, down, my place high is touching that top, the middle of the top surface of the cube. My place low is touching the middle of the bottom surface of the cube. My side open and side across, my two sides are touching the middle of the sides of the cubes. The front and the back are touching the middle of the, so that's one way that the octahedron, and my cube is actually smaller, so it's not gonna work, but the octahedron has these six points and the cube has six faces. So each point is landing in the middle of a cube. Let's go to, let's just talk about that for a second. How is that finding the cube? What's interesting, we've done this before. Some of you have been here, some of you haven't. What feels interesting to discover in your conception of moving the cube, in your mind's idea of moving the cube, or in your feeling sense of moving the cube?
Body. It's totally alien. I have no corners in my universe. All clear curves or shapes. This cube is like a prism.
Interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fabian.
I like to be aware of a number of rotations in my joints that are combined so that I can draw a straight line in the air. I mean, the movement is straight, but inside my body, there's a lot of combined rotations and...
Excellent. Exactly. The irregular polyhedra are adapting to the whole thing happening. Yeah. Inside, which is what's going on in, you know, on so many levels. What else?
I almost never go to back low. That's like a new place to do.
And do you not do it in a crossed position or do you not do it in an open position? Is one worse than the other? I know, most people don't go to crossed back low. That's one thing that we definitely
got. Yeah, I mean, that just requires more work, right? It's neat, it's different. I'm trying to do back mid more when I do movement, but back low is like the least visited place.
Okay, what else? What else, anything else to say or should we move on? Oh, Cassie, go ahead.
I'm very drawn to opposition. So if I'm going in one direction, I wanna instantly reach oppositionally in the opposing to feel the pull.
Right, and do you wanna do that like with your whole body? Like there's one, there's the other, or do you wanna go down there and then up there? Like what feels better?
I don't know, I think they both feel quite nice.
And so that also leads to the idea of counter tension, tension and counter tension. Like there's the pull I'm reaching to left back high, and there's a counter tension helping me balance in right forward low. Or I'm reaching to left back high, and there's a counter tension helping me balance also in the same direction, you know, opposite corner. So tension, counter tension, big thing to think about. Let's move this cube in a bigger way. And then hopefully, actually, for some of you with the symbols, there was a way I wanted to ask this. Actually, blah, 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 blah. Here's what I want to do. I want you to go back into the cube, and this is actually specifically for you, Virginia. I'm not sure what level you're participating today, but to think Like, I want you to think like right forward high. Just think about where is right forward high. Take a minute, where is it? And then, yeah, there you go. There's right forward high. And then maybe find the opposite. So right forward high, let's go left back low. So finding the opposite. What's the opposite? Right forward high, left back low. And just travel along that diagonal a few times. You can cross when you go back and down and open at the top. So crossing right forward high, left back low. Right forward high, left back low. And I'm sitting in a chair, but I'm getting a lot of movement in my torso. Like I'm sitting on an ottoman. So I'm taking it way back. There we go. Now let's just find, with the same hand, left forward high. So left forward high, same hand. There you go. Left forward high, and then the opposite, right back low. Left forward high, crossed, right back low, open. Left forward high, right back low. Left forward high, right back low. So I just went from seated to standing to move this. And like, I feel what a different engagement it is when my feet are on the floor compared to when I'm sitting on my butt. Not to say you can't do it in all of these ways. And actually sometimes it's really fun to do it all seated on a seat, but just to bear in mind what's active and what's participating in any of those things. So let's go now to left back high, crossed with the same hand. We're still using that hand. Left back high. Yeah, so think about, there you go. Left back high and it's crossed to right forward low. Right forward low. Yeah. Again, finding left back high. Good, and right forward low. Yeah, and make sure that you're low. We've talked about this in other classes, and that is that in a single dimension, there's one dimension, it's just up and down. In the single vertical, there's just up and down, vertical dimension. Vertical plane, there are two dimensions. We have our up and down, and we have a little bit of side to side. In the cube, we have three dimensions and they have equal spatial poles. So when I go to this corner and then to that corner, I am equally forward, high, and to the side, to the open. So it's like, as opposed, if I wasn't equal, it could end up in some of this area. We want to try and find that really equal reach. So all three poles have an equal amount. All right, so let's go back to the beginning one more time of this. Let's go to right forward high again. Find right forward high in your body. Where is it? Right forward high. And then the same hand is going to go to the opposite, left back low. Go to the exact opposite, cross it to the back. And then come to center. Same hand, it's going to go to left forward high. Where's left forward high? Yeah, left forward high. And then to the exact opposite diagonal, right back low. Right back low. And then we're going to go back to left back high, crossed, left back high, and we're going to come forward to right forward low. Right forward low. And then our last diagonal is going to be right back high, right back high. There you go, finding right back high, coming to the exact opposite, left forward low, crossing down. So in the cube, in each of these things, one point is going to be open. The exact opposite is going to be crossed, or it's going to be open on top, crossed on the bottom. So either way, as we move around. So now you've actually just done the whole scale of the cube. But if you think about it as the space and start to name the space, then you can get there. And I didn't say hi to Teresa or Abby, but hello. I saw you arrive. So I'm trying to, for my own good, not be as distracted. So if I'm in the middle of a class and I'm in the middle of a thought, I'm trying to stick with what I'm doing instead of going to here and to there as people come and go. Just so you know, I don't love you any less if I don't say hello or goodbye. I love you all. I love having you here. It's all wonderful, but I might not be naming it. And I'm also not reading the chat because it's super distracting for me and it'll take me on a totally different way. So if you do want to take me in a different direction, feel free to do it by unmuting and talking to me.
What about a question?
Yes, go ahead.
What about a question? Sorry, this is very elementary, but my brain is not integrating. When we're doing these shapes, are we maintaining forward or are we integrating the crossing, the twisting in the body, the torso?
Right, you're integrating the twisting, but you are keeping, so in the Laban work, we talk about the key to the space is it could be the room could be the key, or your body could be the key. The key that I'm using is your hip bones. So if this is front, if my hip bones are here, I want to keep front always there. If I move my hip bones there, now my front is there. So I'm going to keep my front to be related to the computer always. So if I'm spiraling up, I can twist in my body, but I have to keep my hips square. So if
that's what I'm asking, is the hips stay forward?
Yep, hips square.
Okay, with hips square as a recovering ballerina, where is below knee toe? Are you square, square? Or
everything is adapting. So as a
sorry, I didn't catch that. And it's just joints. Like we only get one set of knees. So when my hips are one way, where are my knees and ankles?
They could be like this. So here's my hips and I'm gonna cross to, I'm crossing up. I'm not turning out, I'm just doing what feels good. And then back down, I'm trying to keep my hips forward. They're adjusting. You're doing all the rules of keeping your leg in line. Don't injure yourself. You don't need to turn out. There's no, this form doesn't require like dance technique. It just like-
But is it, speaking in shapes, is it more triangles like ballet? Like when you lift from, I'm totally new to Laban. This has been my, you know, load. And I just know in conscious dance, when I'm dancing with someone with ballet, we move in triangles, we lift from triangles. And when I'm dancing with people who learn from the street and other places, it's up and down. And that seems more ergonomic, but you and I probably grew up with in triangles.
Yeah, I don't know how to answer that question because I don't understand what it means in either way. So I don't know.
I think whatever feels safer is a good answer. It's just, I'm taking you on another direction. So I'll let you go back.
So to answer it one more time, do what feels natural in your body, keeping the hips facing front. Yeah. Okay.
Laura?
Yes.
Just wanted to know, is the convention that when you cross and reach to the back, you take the same leg as the arm behind, you cross behind. And when you reach to the front, when you cross to the front, you cross in front?
You know, it can be different in different polyhedra.
Okay.
So if I'm moving in the icosahedron, it might be different than if I'm moving in the cube.
Okay, but for the cube today?
I have to answer that while I'm doing it.
Okay, that's fine. I'm sorry.
My brain is going.
Yeah. Okay. I'll just try to keep noticing. It's okay.
And I'm also like, sorry, I'm on the small, the better camera. It doesn't have as much picture, but it's more higher quality. So like it's narrowed down the field of what you see. I'm trying to make it as big as possible, but let's try this.
It's okay.
So I'm going to move it up just a little bit.
I'm actually glad Dana asked that because I'm struggling a lot with the crossing because I see you on my screen and you look so graceful and I might be getting the direction, but the rest of the three limbs are kind of all over the place.
Right. And so for you, Virginia, right now, what I would say is don't worry about the limbs. Get the directions because you're getting them and you know where to go. And then like after you feel comfortable with that, layer in the limbs. Like I feel like people are, it's like you guys are learning the ABCs, but you want to know like what's the definition of like, you know, some huge word. It's like we're not there yet, so don't worry. Whatever your body does naturally is usually the right answer. I know.
Yeah, but you look so graceful and I look like a spaz.
All right, let's get back to this cue. So yeah, go Dawn. Starting again with the same, we are going to right forward high, find that diagonal, crossing to left back low. I'm crossing my leg behind. Coming in, we are going to go to left forward high. I'm crossing my leg in front. And we're gonna go to right back low. We are gonna go to, I'm crossing behind. Left back high, in to right forward low. And then our last set is going to be right back high, and I'm gonna cross in front to left forward low. So Worry about the actual space first. If you're dancers, you're gonna have to be thinking about the legs, then go ahead and add that layer. But if it is too much, just don't worry about that for right now. That will come later, right? Like the stuff that I'm teaching you is stuff that we spend a whole year learning in class 5 days a week, you know, 5 hours a day. It's not like 1 hour a week for a couple of months, right? Like, so it's pretty complex stuff. And I think that we all can learn this, but we want to have, and I think it's actually already in there. It's just new, right? Like we already know this stuff. It's just putting it into a slightly different container. All right.
Can we do it again like a couple of times in a row? Because there's something really soothing about it.
Yes. So let's stay with that. Same hand, same scale. And we're just going to take it a little faster. We're going to go right forward high to left back low. Left forward high to right back low. Left back high to right forward low. Right back high to left forward low. Let's do it again. Same hand. We'll switch it to the other side and balance it all out in a minute. And you have to understand that I'm also saying the opposite of what I'm actually doing. So that extra brain capacity, which I'm already right left challenged, is like ooh, right forward high. Left back low. Left forward high. Right back low. Left back high. Right forward low. Right back high. Left forward low. Cool. Yeah, yay, I see some happiness over there. Let's try it on the other side. Left back high. Right forward low. Oh, you wanted to do something? I totally started that in the wrong place. Left forward high, left forward high, left forward high to right back low. Left, oh, my brain is so scrambled right now. Like all these things, because there was a period where Michael was like, can we do it from the bottom to the top? And now my brain, like if you change your scales around, it's hard to come back to the reality. All right, we're starting again. Left forward high, right back low. Right forward high, left back low. Right back high, left forward low. Left back high, right forward low. One more time. Left forward high, right back low. Right forward high, left back low. Right back high. Left forward low, left back high, right forward low. Good. All right, my brain is super scrambled. So I'm gonna scramble your brains a little bit more just to balance it out. So if you haven't been here for the space symbols, this is my advice with all of this work. Take it in lightly. Don't worry if you don't get it. It will start to land. It's like a process, right? So we're just gonna do a tiny review and then we're gonna come to the cube. So, and I see we're losing people left, right, and center here. Although some people I know had to leave. Like it takes some capacity to be able to stand it. So go ahead, Malarkey Fairy, family.
Oh, we're still Malarkey family. You know who I am. It's really this is a weighted ball. So I'm not actually like a rhythmic gymnastic, but holding something. I came in from a walk and holding something weighted and having this on my lap, it was very hard for me to come into heart. And I've done intense weekends about heartbeat. So that's just a tip. It's just something that, you know, literally helped me land was this is a very heavy ball. It's a weight ball and having that weight has really helped me process this. I would be completely lost without a prop in this class. I'm not trying to do a performance.
Yeah, that's super awesome. And what you're talking about is grounding and landing and coming in, right? Like how do we come in and land so that we can take it in, right? Because it's pretty intense material. And also because this class has been running for a while, it's, you know, I'm not going to teach the basic scale every time just over and over again, although we will do it a lot often, but and I'm going to show it to you right now. So what is this point? And what is this square with a point in it? And what does it tell us? Go ahead and unmute.
The height is mid-height and it's center, it's place.
Yeah, it's place, it's center. And what tells us it's mid-height?
The dot.
The dot in the middle is everything along the middle level, right?
It's a belly button. It's a belly button, that dot.
Belly button dot. So if you see the belly button, you know it's the middle level. My cat's trying to get out of the room. Okay, so tell me another place. So now we're in the dimensional cross of axis. What are the points in here? And it doesn't matter if you do them in order. What else do you need to know about? Place high, Dawn is going there. So what does place high look like? Can anyone describe it for me? Can anyone tell me what is gonna be in place high? What am I gonna show? What symbol will it look like?
Lines.
Yeah, it will be diagonal lines in the rectangle. That is place high. Anytime those diagonal lines are there, it tells us it's place high. It's in the high level. What's place low gonna look like?
Dark.
Dark.
Black.
Place low. The bottom level is filled in. So then we're gonna go side across and side open. These points aren't gonna tell me if I'm across or if I'm open, but what is it gonna look like? What am I gonna show you? What's the symbol gonna look like? What's the shape and what's gonna be inside of it?
Triangle.
A triangle with a belly button. It means it's in the middle. And here's the other triangle. So there's my two sides, right? So that's inside the octahedron, the most basic scale. That is, oh, and then we have two more. What is the second? So we've shown vertical, the up and the down. We've shown horizontal dimension, side, side. What's the sagittal dimension look like? What are gonna be the symbols for that?
Rectangle with a chimney.
Yes. So here's the rectangle with the chimney. I'm not sure how you guys see it, but the chimney, the nudge is going to be looking at it actually on the left. And then that's, what does this mean? Forward middle. So what's the back going to be? Where is the chimney? On the bottom. So that is backward middle, right? So we have those things. So we know if there's a dot, a belly button, it's in the middle level. If it's got a nudge on top, it's forward, a nudge on the bottom, it's backwards. The triangle or the point coming to one side is a side. So now I'm going to blow your minds. Well, maybe with the cube. And we looked at this last time. So and let's see. Let's try and do it actually evenly. This is interesting. Okay. This may not be. When you see this, is it right or left? Is this on the right or the left?
Right.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so that is, you can see what it is down there, but if I don't show you that, what is that? Yes, Dawn's in there. Can you name it?
Right forward high.
Right forward high. The opposite position is gonna be, we go to the opposite position. What is the opposite position of that? So in that diagonal,
right, back low.
Right forward high into, the opposite is?
Left back low.
Right. There's left back low. It's low, it's filled in. If we imagine that the long point is the edge of the triangle, is at the bottom, that tells us it's the back. Sorry, the down tells us it's back space and the point tells us it's that side, left back low. So this is put together is known as, it's actually float punch, which when we add effort, that would be the float punch diagonal. But alone, that's right forward high, left back low. So now, oh, hold on, I gotta let my cat out. He's trying to break the drawer down. Okay, here is the next one. What is that?
Left forward high.
Yeah. Left forward high. And the opposite, right back low. Now, this is where it gets a little bit confusing. Because this is, hold on. This one. Wait. Oh my God, my right and left scramble from having to do it differently in my body and then say one thing is so messed up. So I might be giving you the wrong thing. What does that look like?
Left high back.
Right back high.
Right back high, yeah.
Yeah, oh, this is right back high. And it should have been left back high if I'd gone in the order of the cube. So Dana actually said the one that would be the right order, but so here's left back high. Yeah, so the thing that's confusing is the down. It makes you want to go, because there's an angle down, you think that you're going down, but in reality, those stripes are telling you it's high. So that is left back high. Two, right forward low. I didn't do that right. There you go. And the way that we put this together is like that. Wait, hold on. Hold on, let me show you on the piece of paper. So this is getting like intense and really hard to teach across a Zoom where my body has to do something the opposite of what it really is. But I posted this picture before. And right here are those opposite positions.
I think you're doing really awesome.
Thanks.
Me too, 100% or more, like so amazing, thank you.
You're welcome. I just wanna say like, it's the scramble, like how well do you know it? Do you know it inside out, upside down, and actually on the other side of your body? Like, okay, so we've got the cube. Now, because we're talking about the names of these things, float, punch, I'm gonna throw in effort. And it actually fits really nicely in with the cube. And it's gonna be new for some of you. Totally new for some of you. And so, yeah, Malarkey Fairy, anything you need to do just to take in some of this information. And I know it's really similar to other things. So sometimes the language, it doesn't quite mean exactly the same thing. And sometimes it does mean exactly the same
thing. No, it's been, I just got my daughter out of a tree by centering her hips. So we're doing it over here. Sorry if it's distracting though. If you want me to turn my camera off, I think she's good, but she was stuck in a tree. Yeah, that was like real.
It's totally fine.
That was Laban tree malarkey. We're doing it.
Good for her for climbing the tree. And how an interesting thing to find out about squaring off the hips that gives you access to getting.
Yeah, back. And thank you for letting me hang out with adults while she does that. So we're doing great. But let me know if it's distracting and you want me to stop camera, because I know it's we've got our own thing going on.
Cool. Okay. So let's try this with effort. So effort, we've talked about before, but it may be new for you today here. And effort is not how hard you work. It's like the qualities of the movement. So when we say effort, when we talk about Laban's effort, which is one element of the whole system, and I'm just gonna quickly go through this. So in Laban, we talk about BESS, body, effort, space, and shape. And those are the four categories of what what constitutes Laban movement analysis. And within body, Bartenieff fundamentals, anatomy, what body part, initiation and follow through. It starts in my knee, it moves up my body to my shoulder, out through my fingertips. Like that's body. I've got rotation, it's a weight shift. I've got breath support. All of that are body words. My right hand, body, my eyeball. And there are ways to motif and symbol all of these things and write all of this stuff. So that is body. Effort is this next level, which is there are four efforts and each one has two, what are they called? Effort factors. So there's light effort, it has a tendency to rise. There's strong effort, it has a tendency to go down. So we think of effort like the spices in the soup. the effort is like, what makes it interesting? And usually in looking at dance or looking at movement, it's when effort qualities change that things become really interesting. We're drawn to that. Our eyes go, something was moving along and then zoop, you know, it suddenly became a thing and we saw that. Or we notice change. Like when it's same, not much notice, but then something happens that changes it, we see that. So when effort qualities change, it becomes interesting. So there's also a flow effort. And in flow, we don't align flow to space at all, but I'll just tell you what it is. There's free flow, which is like childlike and like uncontainable and unstoppable. And then there's bound flow, which is much more sort of mature and adultish and controlled. So in free flow, like kids running around a playground, charging around, doing whatever they want, or like there's no like muscle, not no muscle tension, but it's not being controlled. It's like there's a freedom, there's a release, it's not held. In bound flow, it's held, it's specific. So, I mean, I could do Tai Chi with a very free flow quality, or I could do it with a really bound flow quality. You know, it's just a different quality of movement. Then, so when, we're just gonna let flow go by because it's actually a find to shape instead of space. So the three efforts that we're gonna talk about are lightweight and strongweight, which have an affinity with going up and going down. And that just means that often it does that. It doesn't always do that. And I'm actually coming down very light. I could go up strong, but normally we rise with lightness and we come down with strength. Normally, often, that's the affinity. Doesn't have to, but often does. And then we have the, so that's a find with the vertical, up and down. Lightness rises, strength descends, coming down. So place high, place low. Then in, we have space effort. So this is not big space, geometric space, this is space effort, and it's attending to the space. So like if I come into a room and I'm looking around, where are my friends? Where are they? I'm attending to the space. I'm seeing the things, but I'm not pinpointed. So it's like a global focus, taking in what's around you. Or it could be pinpointed, boom, it's right there, or it's right there. So I go from indirect space where my attention to space is expansive and really taking in a lot, global, the whole starry sky, or one star. I'm looking right at that thing, and that is direct space. So what we say in Laban is that direct space tends to go across, boom, I'm looking at that. And then it opens out as we go into indirect space. So something in the open space tends to be, doesn't have to be, more indirect, boom, crossed space, more direct and pinpointed. So this is how it relates to space. Does not have to, it's just an affinity. We could have a disaffinity where I go direct open and then I go indirect closing, right? And I'm kind of showing it, I'm not a great effort person, or like, I'm not as good at teaching effort as I am at teaching space. Colleen Wall or Colleen Cully, same person, who teaches in the, with Peggy Hackney's crew in that program, is a great effort person. So anyway, we open with indirectness, we cross with directness, ideally, or not ideally, in our affinities and what often happens. And then we have left out the sagittal, and the sagittal is a find with time. So, and when we talk about time in Laban, time effort, we aren't talking about going fast or going slow. We are actually talking about speeding up or slowing down. And in time effort, we tend to go back quickly and come forward sustained. We call it sustained time. And by sustained, we don't mean it's just a sustained note that goes on and on. We just mean that it's coming towards a stop. Doesn't have to stop, but it's slowing down. The speed has changed. So backwards and forwards, the sagittal dimension is affined with back quick, forwards slow. And one way to think about that, and this is what I like to think, is like if you're in a dark hallway and you're walking along, you can't see anything, you're kind of going slow, you're moving forward slow, and then you hit something like a cobweb and you might jump back quickly. So there's just putting the affinity into a image or an idea. So what we're going to do is we're going to throw all of these things together and put them into the cube. So in our first place, when we're going to right forward high, we have up, so we have lightweight. We're open, so we have indirect space. We are going forward, so we're slowing down. We're in sustained time. So the idea, and this is all just language and ideas. Like it doesn't mean that it always has to be this way, but it helps to remember the cube. So as we're going into this, it's kind of like a float. We're floating up to that corner. It's indirect, it's light, it's sustained, it's a float. The exact opposite, boom, we're coming down in the exact opposite effort qualities. So we're coming back down. We're going down, so it's strong. We're crossing over, so it's direct. And we're going backwards, so it's quick. So we're going from this light, sustained, and indirect into, boom, quick time, direct space, and strong weight. So we call that diagonal the float punch, open to close. If I switch it to the other side of my body, it's still the float punch because it is now just on the other side of my body, but I am opening indirect. The same qualities happen whether I'm on this side or on this side in the open space. Yes, go Dawn. Nice punch there. Yeah. So we still want to think it's one side of our body, float, punch. The next one we're going to go to, the next corner, is going to be crossing. We're going to left forward high. So I'm crossing. And do you guys want to unmute and just say what needs to happen? If I'm going to left forward high, what's happening? What are the effort qualities that are happening? I'm going up. So what does that mean?
Light.
Light. Is it direct?
Yeah, it's light. Direct. It's direct. And one more thing. Is it time?
Sustained.
Sustained. Light and direct and sustained. So light, direct, and sustained. What kind of movement? What kind of movement is that? It's actually a good French word.
That glide.
Is you said it, glide. Yeah, it's a glide. We're gliding up. And then in the exact opposite, what do we have back there? We're opening, we're going down and back. So what are our effort qualities of that?
Strong, indirect, quick.
Yeah, strong, indirect, and quick. So we have strong weight because we're going down. We have indirect because it's open. And we have quick because we're going back. So what kind of movement does that look like? What am I doing? If I have a machete, what would I
do? Flash.
Flash. Yeah.
It's so just released from there. When I did it with the ball, it just falls. It is just release.
Yeah.
There's no effort.
Well, it's just... But you have to understand that we're not talking about how hard you're working. We're talking about language that is Laban movement analysis. So okay. There is no effort. It goes super easy. But in Laban effort terms, we are doing a slash.
Oh, cute. Love it.
Yeah, so it's really just a slash. Where sometimes it's going to be different than what it actually means. Than what we say in English. And which is why it's really great to learn this stuff with people who aren't native English speakers, because it lands very differently for them. And I learned a lot from one of my one of the women who was in my year-long program who was, there were a bunch. We had a Korean woman, we had a woman from Singapore, we had a woman from Israel. And all of them, because they had to really read everything. And the way that they then repeated it and took it back out was without having it be already landed in their head in this language was so much more interesting to me. So when I was in the Laban program, and this brings up one of the sort of main themes for me of the Laban work, and that is, it's not technically one of their major themes, but to me it is, and that is the balance of the individual within the group, right? So. And often this is very true for white people, white Western people, is that we don't feel our groupness, that we are a group of white people or whatever, even if we're not just white people. Like we don't assign ourselves that because we don't have to. We're in this individualistic culture. But when you start to like go, oh, wait a minute, if I don't say anything, even though I know the answer, but if I just listen to what Michal or Nayong or Le King say, I'm going to learn something that I don't know. So like it started to shift my participation of being a person, because in this year-long program, it's one full year of the same people every day, day in, day out, the same set of teachers. And it's a set of teachers. Actually, some of them changed partway through the year, but like you have these different relationships. And as you start to develop all of these movement tools, things start to shift and you start to see how, like there was one teacher who was so interesting because I could get her to go down whatever pathway I was interested in by just asking questions. Like all I had to do, and I like this form of learning because then I was learning exactly what I wanted to learn. It was still in the form. And then again, if I let the thing happen, It can happen however it happens. But just this idea of the individual within the group is the thing that I'm trying to say. And the way that we take ourselves, the balance of the whole group, like when we enter a space with other people, how much are we really there with other people? How much am I here just having my own experience, right? Of like what this means and what that means. And I'm so interested in that and on that. And I'm not saying like, I still ask a ton of questions. It doesn't stop me by any means, but it just like that one thing made me start to think about, how am I participating? What will I learn? And in this group, I don't want you to not ask questions. There's no countertext to this, right? I really want you to participate as you, whatever comes up, ask it, say it, share it, all that stuff, because it's so valuable for all of us as a group. But this thing, I never had this understanding of the dynamics of a group and how like the value of each person in the group really holds the space for other people, or like one person's the sad person or one person's the struggling person. And there came a point in the year long where I'd gone through this massive transformation of movement, really shifting my relationship with the ground and how I was a person in a body. And it, like at one point I had like a total breakdown about it. And like in class, because I was normally the strong person who, you know, whatever, could stand up, but wasn't the you know, not afraid to speak ever. But I had this breakdown and the class couldn't handle it. There was one girl in it who was actually a therapist. She was a South African woman and she was a therapist. And she was the only person that like came to me and talked to me about me freaking out. And it was like, oh, because they always see me as being the strong person who's on top of it. So what happens when that person breaks down, right? Where, and being able to play all of these roles. So I learned so much about A group dynamics, my role within a group, what happens, just there's so much more to it than just you're learning this movement, right? It's so much more deep and integrated in our being humans together in the world. And so, and I think that's what this work offers, is this chance to really question. And that's the other thing that starts to happen. When you start to learn effort, you go, oh, well, I'm not that, or I don't do that, or I don't like that. And then you start to judge yourself because of that. Oh, I'm not enough that. I should be more that. And like, it's like suddenly you become aware of all these other possibilities. And then you think, well, I should be like that. But eventually it's not a should or a shouldn't. You are what you are, and it's all good and all okay. You know, it is what it is. But it gives you more tools to look at how it's going on, how are things landing, and then bringing it back into your body. What happens when you bring it back into your body? What are you feeling in that space? What are your needs in that space? What does your body need right now? So that's a whole lot of different things that I talked about.
And more awareness of patterns, of own patterns.
What?
More awareness of our own
totally. Patterns. Totally. And also when you start to, you know, it's like rehearsal is you rehearse something so that you then can do that thing. Like I don't use this space very much. So now I start to use the space. What shifts and changes, right? Or I'm not a very light person. I can do lightness, or I'm not very indirect. Like I'm super direct, I'm super strong, I'm super quick. What happens when I slow it down and I back up? How is that? You know, and it can be very uncomfortable for me or for people around me when they see me in a pattern that they're not familiar with me being, right? So then there's like that aspect of it also, like, oh, now you've added a pattern that like, what are you doing, you weirdo? You know, or, oh, I like this version of you so much better than the way that you normally are, you know, like whatever it is. But just being aware of these things as being stuff. And I remember as a kid growing up in the high school dance recitals and stuff, and like in my dance school, like never being strong enough in my movement. So it was always like, no, you have to do it harder. You have to. So finding the strength in my movement, and then later on, finding the lightness and the subtlety in my movement. It's like there's all of these different layers. And it's not to ask you to be something that you aren't. It's just to give you a chance to practice, right? To play, to try on, to expand the possibilities, to expand the palette. Yeah, and to come into a landing with, oh, okay, this feels good. I feel good in here right now. So that's just part of it. And I think we've come to the end of an hour, and I know some people have to leave. Yeah, so I'm gonna stay on for about 5 more minutes, but we'll just talk and discuss since I gave you a big mouthful. And next week we'll work some more with effort in the cube and in the relationships.
Yeah, that was a powerful piece of conversation there that I have a lot of thoughts about, but I have to stop. But thank you for sharing your ideas about all that. Made me think of teaching in my classroom, you know, my 28 kids, that trying to create that in that context. Bye. Thank you. Bye.
Bye, Dawn. So anything else? Or if you need to leave, feel free to break. Abby, you're unmuted. You got something?
Yeah. So it's best body effort space time.
No, body no. effort space and shape. Oh,
eight.
So now within effort, yes. So those are the four things of Laban. Within just effort, we have time, weight, small space, and flow.
Small space and flow. Time, space, small, nope, flow, weight, got it. And then for, let's just say it's left back high, left would be direct, back would be quick, and high would be floaty.
High would be light.
Light.
So in your right, in weight, you have light or strong.
Yeah.
In time, you have quick or sustained, which means
right.
And in small space with just a small S. So normally we delineate that by a big S or a small S. In small space, you have, which is space effort, you have direct or indirect. And then flow, which isn't a find with space, flow is a find with shape. So I'm just gonna show you this really quick because it's helpful. And it's so funny, it's just like a mnemonic device. But it's the way that we learn it. And I was like, why do we learn it like this? But then I'm like, oh, because it works. Like,
I wrote it down differently. I wrote like light and strong are two separate ones. So I'll just combine them.
They're both weights, yeah.
And then I have flow, childlike, and bound. And then space, I have direct and indirect. And time is fast and slow, or fast and more sustained.
I just want to add chair twin. I have the brown version of your chair.
Oh, who's the chair twin?
She's my chair twin. I can't see your name. I'm sorry, because I'm on my phone, not yeah. getting it. But Abby, I think we're chair twins.
But yeah, oh. Body effort, space, and shape.
Cool. Yeah. Body.
And they showed it was like a tetrahedron, like body effort. Effort, space, and then shape is in the middle.
Cool. Thank you.
Wait, can you hold it up a little longer, Laura?
Yes.
Yeah, I really like the square. I'm still looking forward to it. So I'm really happy that you did it. Because when we were playing with it before, and maybe even last year, it was so much fun. Yes. And then slash.
yeah, it's super fun. And it's fun to really move through it. So we'll play with that more next week. Yeah. Any other comments, questions, concerns?
Can I?
Yeah.
Thanks. I mean, this might be applicable beyond what I'm seeing at the moment, but something about timing and effort makes me think of nervous system, like a cautious going forward and a reflex or a jolt back, safety sensing and that sort of thing. Maybe those are present also in other parts. But that kind of occurred to me clearly.
Totally missed the time of this whole class. I'm just gonna let him in and tell him that it's at the end because tomorrow's at 1 o'clock. But okay, so yeah, and what you just said, like, yeah, shock, back, it's also those reflexes, right? Startle or curl, close in, but that's really like our spine moving in the sagittal, right? That is the sagittal dimension. Quentin. You missed class because it was at 12 today. Tomorrow's class is at 1.
Oh, God.
I know. But we didn't get to the dinosaurs in space, so.
Oh, yeah. My God. That is so terrible.
I know. Okay. I'm going to put it up. Like, if you want to check it out, what happened, it will be on my YouTube channel.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Have a good day.
Yeah. Bye-bye. All right. Anyone else want to say anything? Yeah, Dana.
So besides the discussion about the kind of like the emotional journey that working with this stuff can be, what's interesting to me like I'm really familiar with those basic efforts, but I've never done Laban. So it's the affinities that are new to me. And my first reaction always when somebody goes is, no, this is weird. No, why does that have to be there? We can do that there. So I have a little personal journey to do with that part of it.
Yeah, but the thing about it is like there's affinities and disaffinities, and it's just more layering of concepts on this, right? It isn't that it's always like that. It's just that it's often like that. And if you look at enough movement and you analyze it, you're like, oh yeah, they are going up with lightness. Mm. They're coming down with strength. Oh, they are crossing more direct. Like it wasn't built out of nowhere. It was built out of, oh yeah, it actually makes sense. But it doesn't have to be. You can always do it totally differently, right? It just gives you more choice. Yeah. Yes. Cool. All right. I'm going to let you all go. Thank you so much for coming. Lovely to see you. And yeah. Ciao.
Bye-bye.